Okay, so error correction is about protecting data against noise. So you have data and you send it to someone and that gets corrupted, so what will that person do? So this is, you can't do that. So really the idea is very simple. You take your data, you encode it by adding judicious redundancy and in redundant form, and you send that thing which is called the code word. The code word also gets corrupted, but somehow the receiver, because of the redundancy built into data, is able to, despite the errors, figure out what the original data was. And this transmission can really be in space or time. So what I mean is space means you can actually communicate across the internet, or it could actually be what is increasingly important. You could write data on the cloud and then read it later, and that is sort of communication in time because you're reading data at a later time. And just to make sure we are on the same page, a very trivial code would be whenever you want to send a bit, just repeat it 3 times. So this is like a factor of 3-fold redundancy, but the nice thing is, it's pretty clear if one of the bits gets flipped, you can always take the majority of the 3 copies and you'll get the correct answer. So this gives you a little bit of taste of how redundancy can help you figure out the true data despite some errors, okay? And this is obviously a very naive scheme. Coding theory is about much understanding what the best schemes would be. And this talk is, I'm a theoretician, and this talk will primarily focus on the theoretical questions, but most of these questions have real roots in applications. Codes are all around us in all sorts of fancy things like deep space communication, the cloud storage, memory in your computers and so on, and even simple things like when you receive a package on UPS, that little barcode is something which uses certain algebraic codes called Reed-Solomon codes. So it's all around us. Just good to keep in mind. But this talk will be about the mathematics of codes and the algorithmic aspects of it. So what is formally a code? A code gives you a way to take k symbols over some alphabet sigma and encode it into a longer redundant string of n symbols. So in that example I gave you, sigma was 0, 1, k was 1. You took one bit, repeated it 3 times. Okay. And a pictorial image you should have is that you have sigma to the k code words, but they sit in a much bigger space. So they're going to be far apart from each other. They're going to be very sparsely populated so that if one of the code words gets corrupted and you get the red point, it's still kind of closer to that code word than anything else. It resembles that code word more than anything else, so you can try to do error correction. And an important parameter of the code is how efficient this code is. So clearly, if you throw in a lot of redundancy, you can get better guarantees, but we don't want to do that because that's expensive. So redundancy is, I will measure by the following normalized quantity. There are k true information symbols amongst n symbols. So the number of redundant symbols is n minus k. And I'd like to normalize it to be something between 0 and 1. So the redundancy is n minus k by n. And it's also common to talk about the rate, which is just 1 minus the redundancy. But for the talk, I'll try to stick with redundancy. So you try to minimize the redundancy. For example, for the 3-fold repetition code, where k was 1 and n was 3, the redundancy is 2/3. 2/3 of your symbols are redundant. They are there only to protect data against errors. Okay, so you would like to minimize redundancy. So what are the broad challenges in coding theory? You might have some noise model for your particular application or physics in mind. And for that noise model, and I'll give many examples, you would like to understand what is the smallest redundancy possible. So what is the true information theoretic limit at which you can operate as a function of the noise level? So this is often just a probability or combinatorics question. You would like to know what's the best thing you can do. And since you also want to use codes, once you understand that, you would like to actually construct nice coding schemes which will operate close to that optimal trade-off. And it goes hand in hand with the third goal, which is that you want these codes to have nice structure where you can encode with these codes and error correct with these codes efficiently as well. Okay, so the first thing sort of gives you a baseline for what you could shoot for. And the second and third questions are more algorithmic computer science flavor, where you try to get that with efficient algorithms. Okay, and just to give some example of the broad general 3-pronged challenge, so some example noise models, and this, I'll give classic examples from Shannon's work from 1948. We really, the single paper basically started these whole fields. So one common channel is the binary symmetric channel, where you send bits, and each time a bit goes by, it gets flipped independently of all the other bits with the probability p, okay, which is some number between, say, 0 and half. And here Shannon characterized, and it's well known, that the optimal redundancy is this entropy function. So h of p, this is some concave function. For p equals 0, it is 0. If there is no noise, you don't need any redundancy. When p becomes 1 half, you're basically flipping each bit with probability half, which means you're getting a random string at the output. So clearly, you can't do any error correction. The redundancy becomes 1. And in between, it just grows in this way. Okay? And another channel, which is even simpler, is the erasure channel, where each bit goes by, it never gets flipped, but with some probability alpha, it gets, the bit goes missing. which you can model as it gets replaced with a question mark. You're just not sure what the bit is. So in this case, the optimal redundancy is alpha. And it's pretty clear you can't do better than alpha, because in a long string of n bits, about alpha fraction of the bits are going to go missing. Right? So you cannot send information at a rate more than 1 minus alpha, which means your redundancy should be alpha. And it turns out you can actually achieve these things. So these are, for simple channels, answers the first question. So we know what the best codes could do. And more generally, there are these things called discrete memoryless channels in Shannon's probabilistic model. And for all of those, Shannon gave a formula for what the best redundancy is. Okay, and then the challenge becomes the second and third questions. How do you realize the potential of codes in these models by constructing and giving algorithms for these codes? Now, noise can come in different flavors, and I'll give a few examples in this talk. The first one I've already mentioned is errors could be caused randomly, like the way Shannon modeled. And a model which we like a lot in computer science, because our worst case model, is you say that the channel can do anything it wants, subject to a total limit on the number of errors or erasures it causes. This is a more combinatorial view pioneered by Hamming around the same time. And that's also an important model. And there are some hybrid models as well, where you could say the channel is maybe neither as optimistic as Shannon or as pessimistic as Hamming, somewhere in between. And maybe I'll mention something about that. So that's basically how errors are caused, randomly or worst case. Roughly, that's the two main things. But then the noise itself, what actually does the noise do? So you can have various kinds of noise. One thing is, for example, I send a bit, the bit can get flipped. Or you can also, you will send the bit as some real number, and then that you could have Gaussian noise acting on it. That's a continuous noise model. So here, actually, the symbols get distorted. Or erasure is a simpler model where symbols just go missing, and you know that they go missing. Deletions, which I'll come to, is where symbols go missing, but you don't know that they've gone missing. So that's a kind of a harsher model. And there are some various other things in network coding these days. You can view code words as matrices, and then the matrices get distorted by low rank error matrices. So rank is a metric which is used there. And one thing which is also important is whether you're coding over bits or over large alphabet. If you're doing things over the internet, packets are large alphabet things. Whereas if you're sending bits, then you're sending 0, 1. And then that matters, also affects the noise model. Okay, so there are various kinds of how errors are caused, types of noise. And you can imagine the cross product of these leads to lots of plethora of questions in coding theory. And there are some common tools to address all of these things, but sometimes you need problem-dependent tools. And all of these combinations, many of these are classic problems. There have been lots of advances, both in theory and practice. But despite the richness of the field, several new insights continue to emerge in the field at a good rate, which is nice. And the aim of this talk is just to give you a glimpse of some of these recent results on some of these models, and maybe also mention some open questions. Okay, so that's sort of the introduction to the talk. Any questions so far? No? Very good. So again, as I said, the talk will be organized into multiple parts. Each part will be more or less self-contained, which is hopefully a good thing for a morning talk. So hopefully all of those parts will be interesting to you. But if you lose me a little bit in one of the parts, you can always tune back in for the next one. The first one will be a very computer science-oriented thing, where worst-case errors. So I'm going to talk about errors, which are worst-case. And I'll start warm up by a very simple problem, which probably many of you have seen and know how to solve, which is worst-case erasures. So what do I mean by this? We have our coding setup. You have a message, which you encode into a code word C. The code word goes through some channel. Maybe it's like it's packets on the internet. And some of the packets go missing. But you know which packets go missing. Maybe there's a packet header or something. So you know which packets go missing. So you basically get this string with some question marks. And let's say E of these array symbols are erased. OK? So the question here is going to be, for a particular, what's the best trade-off you can have between E, K, and N? Right. So first of all, since you have K symbols, the message consists of K symbols, at the receiver end, you do need at least K unerased symbols. Right? Otherwise, you cannot hope to recover the data, because you cannot create information. You have K bits of symbols of information at the source. You need K symbols at the end. So the question is, can we be greedy and say that can we design a code which corrects n minus k erasures, which is really the best you can hope for. Basically, all but the minimum required amount of data has been erased. Can you still do array recovery? And turns out you can do this. And the solution is actually, I'll show you the solution. It's very simple, just based on polynomial interpolation. So how do we do this? It's pretty classical stuff. You view the message as some sort of polynomial. So it is important here that the coding happens over a big alphabet sigma. Sigma needs to be big. So you view a message as a polynomial, and you do what's called the Reed-Solomon encoding of this, where you take this polynomial and you evaluate it at n distinct elements in a field. Sigma should be a field of at least n elements. And you basically take this degree k polynomial, k minus 1 polynomial, evaluate it at n points. That's your code word. And why is this good? If out of these n values you get any k of them, you know the value of a degree k minus 1 polynomial at k distinct places. You can do interpolation and uniquely recover the polynomial. And that's it. That's the entire solution. That's optimal. You cannot do better than this. And that's a clean solution, also very efficient, because you can do polynomial evaluation and interpolation very quickly, both in theory and practice. Okay, so, and this is used all over the place. But what about errors? So this was easy because whenever you got some information, you knew it was absolutely correct. Now, in the other case, when there are errors, up to some e of these symbols are wrong. But the challenge now is you don't know which symbols are wrong. What can you do? Well, first of all, what's the best trade-off you can have? So if you take two different code words of a Reed-Solomon code, because they are both evaluations of degree k minus 1 polynomial, and because of degree k minus 1 polynomial is determined by k values, it's pretty easy to see that these two code words will be far away from each other. They'll differ in more than n minus k places. Okay. And because of this, if I get a received word which is within n minus k by 2 of one of any of the code words, the center will be uniquely determined. So if up to n minus k by 2 errors happen, you can uniquely identify which code word you started from, because the code words are far away from each other. That's all. Okay. And that's good. But then how do you find the center efficiently? That's not so easy, because these spaces have exponentially many code words. You cannot do any brute force thing. But turns out, fortunately, you know, really from 1960 onwards, there's a slew of algorithms which give efficient algorithms for this problem to correct these many errors. And these algorithms are heavily optimized and used in practice, so that's very good. Okay, so all this is very classical stuff. But now suppose we want to correct more errors. So we corrected n minus k by 2 errors. What about if I want to correct even, suppose my system is more noisy, and this is important in many applications, what can I do? It turns out, if I always want to get the correct answer, message unambiguously as the correct answer, this is really the limit. So the most errors you can correct is n minus k by 2. And I would like you to remember this in this form. The redundancy, remember, was n minus k by n. So this means that the redundancy needs to be at least 2 times the error fraction you target. If you want to correct 30% errors, you need at least 60% of your symbols to be redundant. And this is not, I won't prove this, but the proof is not very difficult. Basically, you can, when you have more errors, there will be some bad pair of code words such that you can find some received word which is within distance e of both of these code words. Basically, you know, at this point, there are some 2 code words with distance n minus k plus 1, so you can find this midpoint. And if you happen to start with C and we are unlucky to get this R, you really cannot uniquely figure out if you came from C or from C tilde. Okay, that's really the reason. But the thing is that this can happen, but this is very unlikely the way these code words pack in high dimensional space. They are so sparse. For typical error patterns, this will almost never happen. But on the other hand, we want to deal with the worst case model. We don't want to get into the specifics of how the error actually occurs. You know, we like worst case models because, you know, they're very permissive and they give you a lot of robustness. So one clean and powerful approach is this problem called list decoding, where we say that in cases where you're unlucky that there may be more than one code word, just give me the list of code words. Okay, in this case, you can maybe output both of these. Okay, and that's the list decoding problem. So here, for list decoding from an error fraction row, so you have some received word R, and again, pictorially, you get this thing, but now the number of errors are so many that you might have multiple code words which could resemble the received word, and your goal is to output all of them. So that's the problem. So you have the code, you have some error fraction row, given an input received word, you list all the code words which are within the distance row from this. Well, distance is Hamming distance, where you differ in at most row fraction of places. And now there are a couple of comments. First of all, if you want to do this efficiently, you need the guarantee that wherever your center R is, you're not going to get too many points in that ball of radius rho times n, because otherwise you can't output them all. So you need to design a good code where this will happen. And also, you cannot go ahead and solve this problem by brute force. So you need to exploit the code structure to efficiently find this list of code words. And this notion goes back to the late 50s, but really it is revived algorithmically only since the late 80s. And the original motivations really came from cryptography and complexity and so on. Okay, but now there are a lot of work from a communication angle as well. Now, when you first see list decoding, you immediately, the natural reaction is, well, is this a useful model at all? What do I do with a list? You know, when I communicate, I want to know what I communicated uniquely. And there are various answers. I won't, you know, dwell upon this too much, but just three main points is typically, for typical noise models, the list will only have one code word. And indeed, we have run experiments with these Reed-Solomon and related codes, and we almost rarely see list size more than one. But the nice thing is, despite this, it removes the need to model the channel behavior precisely. You just say it's a worst-case model, and in the pathological case, you just say, well, I'll output more than one code word. And of course, it's better than just giving up. Rather than saying, I have no clue, it's probably better to say it's one of these three possibilities, right? And perhaps what is the reason for a lot of interest in list decoding in the computer science thing is it's a very versatile primitive, which has lots of applications beyond communication and storage in complexity and cryptography. It somehow seems to, I won't have too much time to talk about this, but it somehow seems to be the really nice, robust notion with many applications. Okay, so as I said, all this is fine, but does the list decoding buy you anything? And it turns out with list decoding, you can actually do something very nice. I said that if you want to always get a unique correct answer, the redundancy needs to be twice the error fraction. Turns out with list decoding, you can save this factor too. You can make the redundancy as close as you want to the error fraction, and you can still have list decodable codes. And in work with a couple of my students, we now have explicit constructions of codes which realize this potential. So formally, for any error fraction rho and any desired parameter epsilon, you can correct a fraction rho of worst case errors with the redundancy as close to rho as you want. So instead of 2 times rho, it can be as small as 1 plus epsilon times rho. And I want to just quickly say why this is really the best you can hope for. Remember, rho fraction of errors occur, and they are worst case. So the adversary could even be nice to you and tell you that, you know what, I'm going to just mess up the last rho and symbols in your code word. The adversary can just tell you that. You can always replace that with zeros or something. And now, so whatever decoding you do, all the information you get must come from the first 1 minus rho fraction of symbols. So you cannot push more than 1 minus rho times n symbols of through this code word, because the last rho n is just junk. So k has to be at most this, which means the redundancy, the proportion of symbols which are redundant, needs to be at least rho. So this is sort of an absolutely naive and trivial limit that you need redundancy at least the error fraction. And it turns out with list decoding, you can actually realize this. Yeah?
Do you care about how long the list?
Yes, so I'm going to mention this in the next slide. So there are, like with any things, there are some caveats. And But maybe the correct way to think about it, the worst case bounds are big, but you should really think of typically the list size will be 1. So some of that issue is not very prevalent. Yeah.
What do you pay for the epsilon?
What do you pay for the epsilon in the list size? Yeah. Okay. I'll come to that in the next slide, I think. Yeah. So that epsilon enters into some other parameters like the alphabet size and the list size. So you do pay a price for getting closer and closer to optimality. Okay. And what are the codes? I'll just tell you what the codes are. Now, another nice thing about that result is that it doesn't give you any contrived code, but it actually takes a very well-known code, Reed-Solomon, and a small change to it gives these codes, which is also nice because giving a completely new code makes it more unlikely it will be, you know, used or deployed. But if you just give a better algorithm for an existing code, that's slightly a better thing. So what's the Reed-Solomon coding? As I said, take a degree k minus 1 polynomial, evaluate it at n distinct points. Here, let me say my field is integers mod of prime, so these are just numbers. And the code we give here is plays a little game with the alphabet size. It does something called folding. So it takes these n symbols and somehow packages them as n over 3 symbols over a slightly bigger alphabet. So in some sense, your packet size becomes 3 times as long. But the information is the same thing, so you don't lose any redundancy here. You're just repackaging information. Okay. And this is, again, as I said, this is modulo prime. The actual construction uses extension fields. And this is three-way folding. 3 was just for illustration. In general, you have a parameter m, and you take the first m symbols, make it a new m mega symbol, right? And then the next m symbols make it the next mega symbol, and so on. And if you do this, we give an algorithm which can correct this fraction of errors. You don't have to look at, it looks a bit complicated, but the main thing you need to know is that as I let m grow, and s is the parameter which is also growing, this thing can approach tau. Okay, so for these codes, as I increase m, I get better and better algorithms. And this already illustrates to you one of the trade-offs which Andrew was asking about. So this m is going to be a function of epsilon. So as you make pick m bigger, your alphabet size is already growing. Okay, so a few words about the algorithm, and this is the only thing I'll say. So it turns out the algorithm is actually very simple in the sense that it's just linear algebra. There are two main steps, and both steps really just amount to solving a linear system. So in that sense, it's very efficient. In fact, a few years back, I had a fresh incoming freshman who just implemented this within, you know, 3-4 days. You know, not highly optimized, but he got it working. It's not. It's very very simple. And indeed, I mean, in ensuing experiments, we almost rarely saw a list which is more than one. Theoretically, what can we prove? And this goes back to Akshay's question. So if you want to be within epsilon of the optimality, the complexity and the list size are very big. The complexity is really dictated by the fact that you might get a big list of size n to the 1 over epsilon, which you have to prove. So that's very bad. But many follow-ups have addressed this, including some of my own works. And this has led to some very nice connections with this thing which I call linear algebraic pseudo-randomness. So you try to create versions of things like subspaces which have some very nice random-like properties, and they interface very nicely with this. So I won't be able to go into this, but for those who are interested, I can tell you more. And one more thing is that this new approach, the linear algebraic approach, also has enabled us to give better codes for the rank metric, which were open for a long time. Okay? So that's all I want to say about this result. So the main punchline you should take away is that with list decoding, in an efficient sense, you can approach redundancy close to error fraction, and the errors are worst case. But the price you pay is that the alphabet size is big, and it somehow has to grow with epsilon. So even though it doesn't have to be this big, the list size has to grow with epsilon. Okay, there are trade-offs there, which I'm not mentioning, but those do exist. So the last slide on this part would be, again, if you want to just remember one punchline, you can say that list decoding, our understanding is pretty good over large alphabets. We have basically optimal redundancy codes. But you can then ask, what about codes with just over bits, where you can't do these things like read Solomon? If I just want to send bits and encode them, what can you do? Here, the best redundancy for error fraction row, again, turns out to be this entropy of row. So you need a bit higher redundancy. But we do not know any code constructions which come close to this. So that's a huge challenge. So basically, matching this optimality which we have over large alphabets over bits is wide open. And one other thing is that we made a little change to Reed Solomon codes to get these optimal codes. You can go back and ask, what about Reed Solomon codes themselves, which are really one of the most preeminent codes, algebraic codes. And there we have this algorithm from my thesis which gave this trade-off that you can correct. The redundancy you needed is almost twice rho, but you can save this rho square. So it's a bit smaller than twice rho. And that still remains the best known redundancy. So we don't know if we can improve this trade-off for just Reed Solomon codes. So it's possible there are some Reed Solomon codes which you can do decode better, and we just don't know. Okay? So that's about worst case errors. Any questions about this?
So for the folded Reed Solomon code,
N over M, yeah. But really, you should think of M as some fixed constant which is growing with epsilon. And indeed, you can even set M to be 5 or 6 and stuff like that. Those things are also meaningful. This is the way I presented it, is an asymptotic sense. But in our paper, we in fact talk about even fixing M and so on. Yeah. But N is growing, so. Yeah.
This last result?
Yeah.
What's the list size?
The list size here can be pretty good. It can be something like N. The worst case list size is like N or something, where N is the length of the code. And if you come away from this bound, if you allow me tau, which is a little bit bigger than this, say epsilon factor bigger than this, 1 plus epsilon times this, the list size would be 1 over epsilon. So this has very good list size. Very good.
If I make the list size even bigger, I should be able to do better, right?
Yeah, but yes, that's what we don't know. It's possible that if you try to go better than this trade-off, there is a sharp jump, like a phase transition.
Yeah.
So the list size would be like small, like say polynomial n or n square up to this trade-off. If you exceed it, it could potentially be exponential.
Okay.
And we don't understand that. And that's somehow an intertwined challenge with this. Yeah.
So the cases were supposed list size 2 or list size 3.
Right.
Really small, say yeah. 2.
Yeah.
What is?
So this trade-off, there is actually a precise, you can throw in the list size as a parameter, and the tau and rho and L, there is a particular trade-off in our work.
Okay.
But
suppose, what about the binary case where you have each row?
Yeah.
I guess when list size is polynomial, but suppose list size is a small constant, is there?
So there are some bounds, but we still don't know the exact trade-offs. Yeah. And certainly, if you fix the list size to be 2 or 3, we are very far from knowing what the best trade-off is.
It goes back to the combinatorial.
Yeah, combinatorial thing. So. Somehow, list decoding, if you let the list size grow, then you can understand what the trade-off is. For any fixed list size, the problem is basically hopeless, at least with current technology. All right, so that's the first part. So now for an independent second part, which will, so this was worst case errors. Now I want to talk about random errors, which is also another very important strand in coding theory research. Okay. And okay, so this will be sort of independent, so you can follow me along here. So again, this is the same setup. You have a message, you encode it into a code word, but now the noise is, earlier I talked about a channel which flipped row n bits arbitrarily. But now this is a nice channel which will, for each bit, flip it with probability rho independently. So this is a more benign noise model. It's a random noise model. And then, of course, there is a chance it could flip everything. So in this case, you cannot hope to always get the correct answer. But you hope that over the channel noise, the decoder will be able to figure out the correct message with overwhelming probability. And that's really what Shannon proved. So Shannon proved that for any epsilon, if you make your n big enough, so if you work with, if you buffer enough bits so that you send, you know, n bits at a time, a big enough block, then there exists a coding scheme to transmit messages from this domain. So you can encode these many messages into 0, 1 to the n, such that your miscommunication probability is pretty good. So it falls off exponentially in n. Okay? And what does this mean? This means that the redundancy of the code, so you really have 1 minus h rho minus epsilon n data symbols out of n symbols. So the redundancy is h of rho plus epsilon. So what Shannon proved is that you can approach this optimal redundancy of h of rho, provided we tolerate some delay. So you have to just buffer enough bits to send it, and then you get very good resilience to noise. Okay, this was Shannon's result. But the problem is that this was one of the early illustrations of the probabilistic method. He showed these codes exist, but he had gave no method to construct these codes or efficiently use these codes. Okay, and if you go back to these challenges, what Shannon did was he nailed down part one. So he said what the potential of coding is, which is already remarkable. And it opened the challenge of B and C, which is how do you construct these codes? How do you give algorithms for those codes? Okay, and that's what people have been trying to do ever since. Okay. So the challenge of achieving capacity is the following. So now I want to have two functions which should be efficient, where I take k symbols and map it to n symbols, encoding, and the decoder does the opposite. And k should be big enough so that my redundancy is close to the optimality, such that the following happens. If I take any message, I encode it, the BSE acts on the code word, and I decode it, the chance that I fail to get M should be very small. Okay, I just say it's much smaller than epsilon, but you can make this very tiny. That's what the goal is. And the second and third thing is that Shannon said, how big does N need to be? N needs to be about 1 over epsilon square, and that's tight. If you do less than that, you cannot achieve this. So you would like to be more or less in the same ballpark. You would like N to be not much bigger than 1 over epsilon. And you would like the encoding and decoding complexity to be polynomial in N or polynomial in 1 over epsilon. So the way I'll formulate this challenge of achieving Shannon capacity is the following. There is a single parameter epsilon, which is the gap to capacity. How close to optimality do you want your system to operate in terms of redundancy? And the goal is to design a scheme where the overall complexity is polynomially growing in this. Okay? And of course, you would like to optimize that polynomial also, but for first blush, you would like to get polynomial complexity. Okay, that is the challenge. And despite lots of work, this challenge was not actually answered until recently. There are various proposals to achieve capacity. For example, already Forney's work in 66 achieved capacity, but the problem was his complexity. For any fixed epsilon, it was polynomial, but if you looked at the dependence on epsilon, it was exponential in 1 over epsilon. And there are various schemes, low density parity check codes and so on, but these are actually not even proven to achieve capacity for arbitrary channels. So you cannot ask this question. And a remarkable thing happened in 2008, which made me to revisit this question, where Ari Khan gave this new family of codes called polar codes, widely celebrated, really remarkable invention. And he proved that in the limit of large n, these actually achieve capacity. And in fact, they do so with the complexity, which is only n log n. Unfortunately, however, he did not give any finite bounds. So if you want to be within epsilon of capacity, what's the n you need? He did not give any finite bounds on that. And that's what we basically proved. So we took Arikan's polar codes and said that these are very good in the sense that they allow you to operate at rates within epsilon of optimality with overall complexity exactly what we want. And this was also done independently by researchers at EPFL, and this was with Patrick Shea, who was a student of mine. And one thing I want to emphasize is that so far these are the first and only known such codes which have this particular property. And this was for binary alphabets. We also have an extension for all fixed alphabets, and that poses some additional challenges, okay? So in the next couple of slides, I'll give you a little bit of glimpse of what goes into this under the hood in this. So it turns out if you want to construct codes for this binary symmetric channel where each bit is flipped with probability p, you can really think of this in a dual source coding setting, which is, or a compression problem, okay? And this again will be a self-contained thing. So what's the linear compression scheme? Assume I get n IID bits, where each bit is 1 with probability rho and 0 with probability 1 minus rho. So, okay, so n IID rho biased bits. So the amount of information in them is only h of rho times n. So I would like to compress these things to their entropy. You know, so that I just want to do compression to their, I want to do a, you know, optimal compression. But I would like this compression, if you just wanted that, there are various ways to do this, but I would like this compression to be linear. By which I mean that I want a linear map which will send these n bits to m bits where m is pretty close to the optimal bound. And I want to find such a matrix H and also a decompression algorithm which should be efficient such that when I take a random sample from this source, compress it, and then decompress it, I should get back my original sample with high probability. Exactly, that's absolutely the correct intuition. That's how, in fact, how the reduction works. Yeah. Right. So you're able to figure out, this decompressor will actually tell you where the errors occur, and of course, that's enough to figure out the code. Yeah. And of course, in general, this is impossible, right? Because this is an HX equals something is an underdetermined system, because you only get M equations in N variables. You cannot solve it in general, but because your X comes from this random source, with high probability, you can solve it. And indeed, you can prove such matrices H exist just randomly, but the challenge is to find an explicit matrix and an efficient algorithm. Okay, same kind of thing. And the key tool which Arikan uses to get these things are something called polarizing matrices, which are very nice objects in themselves. So here it's an invertible matrix. That matrix was rectangular, but this is now a square invertible matrix. On the left-hand side, you feed it n IID copies. On the right-hand side, it's going to produce n bits because it's an n by n matrix. At the source, the entropy of any bit given the previous things is the same because it's independent of the rest. But these polarizing matrices have this remarkable property that for at the output, for most of the indices, the entropy you get polarizes to either 0 or 1. So if you take a tip in any bit I here, most of the bits, either that on average that will be bit will be completely determined by the previous things, or it will be completely undetermined, completely random. So what happens is that this entropy, which is equally spread at the input, gets polarized into zeros and ones at the output. And just by conservation of entropy, the correct fraction of entropies will be close to one. And the rest will be close to zero. So at the output, you only need to output those UIs where the entropy is somewhat non-substantial. All the entropies which are very low, you can just drop. And by conservation of entropy, that gives you the correct amount of compression. Okay? This is just a very high-level view, but this is what Arikan does. Okay, and in fact, not only that, he actually shows what this matrix should be. This is as explicit as it gets. He says that take this 1, 1, 0, 1 and take its tensor Kronecker product m times. So that's a 2 to the m by 2 to the m matrix. He proves this matrix is polarizing. Okay, so I won't be able to do that proof, but just to give you a little flavor of what happens, take the m equals 1 case here. So you just have 2 bits at the input and 2 bits at the output. What you're doing is that the first bit is x1 plus x2, the second bit is x2. Now, the point is, unless the input bit is completely random or determined, when you sum up 2 copies of an IID random bit, its entropy is going to go up. Okay, this is something you can easily check. So the entropy of U1 is bigger, and therefore by conservation of, by just the chain rule and conservation of entropy, the entropy of U2 given U1 must be lower, so that the two things add up to the correct amount. So what you have done here is that you have taken 2 entropies which are equal, at the output produced 2 entropies which are slightly far apart. And this tensor product basically at some high level just do a recursive application of this to drive apart these entropies further and further apart till they all go down and settle to either 0 or 1. And then the correct fraction are close to 1 and you just output those. And what we had to do for our result is basically we had to prove rate of convergence thing. So what Arikan basically said, Arikan's thing will say that the fraction of entropies which are somewhat large is exactly the proportion you would like. But he proved that in the limit as n goes to infinity. And what we prove is basically if you want to be within epsilon of this limiting value, you only need to take n, which is polynomial in 1 over epsilon. And that tells us that if you want to be within epsilon of the optimal redundancy, for either the compression or the error correction, you only need to work with codes which have length polynomial 1 over epsilon. And then we, with additional ideas, we also give, and basically Arikan's algorithm itself can then be implemented in polynomial time. Okay? And what really the analysis amounts to is some basic inequalities in probability, which is if you take some random variable and some two IID copies of it, how much does the entropy increase? So I said in that slide that the entropy goes up in one of them, but you need to understand how much it goes up by so that you can take that limiting statement and understand the speed at which it polarizes. Okay, so at a high level, that makes sense. And that's basically what we do. And we also do the similar thing for the non-binary case when the input's random variable is not on bits, but other things. And there, some more. There, we don't have a very clean picture, but we still are able to prove some result like this. Okay. Okay, so I think in the interest of time, I'll skip this act. So the act 2.5, basically, I talked about random models and worst case models. So we also have some results where which bridge between these two. And these are very interesting where you say that, so I'll just say what the model is. The hybrid model is something which Lipton proposed, which is a bounded adversarial model, where you say the channel can flip up to row fraction of symbols in any way. It doesn't have to do IID errors. But the channel itself should be efficient. It, you know, the channel should not be solving some NP-hard problem to create the worst possible errors for you. And this is well motivated because the trouble with channels is that they may be unpredictable. They could be bursty, so they could violate the assumption of IID errors. But they're not computationally intensive, typically, right? So they're just unpredictable, but they're not really doing something nasty by solving some difficult problem. So if you assume that the channel is operating with low complexity, then it turns out you can leverage this, and we can basically get we don't have to read that thing, but at a high level, we prove that you can get the benefits of the random errors with an efficiency. Sorry, you can get the benefits of worst case error with an efficiency similar to the random errors. So somehow you can bridge between these two things in a nice way by imposing that the channel has good redundancy. Okay. Okay. So when should I finish? Bye. Okay, 15 minutes. Okay, then I'll at least mention the result on deletions. I'll try to wrap up in 10 to 15 minutes. Okay, any questions so far? Yeah. But I'm happy to take more questions on the previous part and skip one or this or the next part. Okay, so deletions. So now we'll go back to another model. So again, this again shows.
Just yeah. From the polar codes, yeah. It is from Arikan's work, it is unclear, right? How do you get those fraction? Correct fraction of rows,
yeah,
your output has high entropy.
Oh, so how do you compute which rows?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, so from Arikan's work, it isn't, but you know, but we can subsequent work, and we also do this, but it was also done independently by others, so you can actually compute. There is no nice description of which rows have high entropy and which rows have low entropy, but you can compute that
so
efficiently.
The remaining question in
polar, well, there may be, I guess, one big remaining question is moving all this thing into practice. So there is a feeling that polar codes can operate at very low energy. So they are apparently, I'm not an expert on this at all, but apparently they are a good strong contender for the next 5G, where they want to really push data at much higher rates. So energy per bit becomes a very important thing. And some of polar codes, because operations are simple, can operate at low energy. So, but, so I think taking it to practice is one big challenge. Yeah. How do you do decoding is basically, you can just think of the decompression. So basically, if a bit has enough entropy, it will be output. And if a bit is determined by the previous bits, so you, in principle, you know what the bit is. But you're right. It's not clear why you can do that efficiently. But the structure of the transform, which has a very FFT-like flavor, allows you to figure out the maximum likelihood value for the bit efficiently. Yeah. So there's a lot under the hood to make this efficient. Not at all obvious. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, definitely there is, you have to do that. And yeah. Okay, so any other questions? Okay, then let's talk a little bit about deletions, which is a nasty model where you have n symbols, you get, the channel simply deletes some number of symbols. So you get a subsequence of this thing. For example, you have these things, you get this you know, you can have coding over big alphabet or bits and you get these things. So the key point is the receiver gets a subsequence, and unlike erasure question where which I talked about earlier, where you have these question marks which tell you where you were missing information, here you have no clue which symbols are gone. So you lose all the synchronization, and that makes life very difficult. Okay, so it makes much more challenging than the erasure model. So what do we do? So again, what's the problem? The coding problem is basically to design a clever choice of code words, subset of sigma to the n, such that any code word can be uniquely determined from any of its subsequence of a length n minus s. Somehow there is enough redundancy that if I just give you a subsequence of the code word, I can go back and figure out what the code word is. Now, one point here is that, again, this illustrates the importance of the alphabet. If I allow sigma to grow with n, I can simply put a little packet header, right? So I can say that the ith symbol is simply I comma alpha. And then when I get I comma alpha, I know I have received the ith symbol. So I can somehow reduce it to the model of erasures if my alphabet is big enough to include if it's big enough of size, at least n or something. But it's much more challenging over fixed alphabets, most notably 0, 1. So you cannot do this game. So if you just are coding over 0, 1, how do you do this? Now, this is a very, very basic question in combinatorics and so on, but I think it's also becoming increasingly relevant with lots of applications in genome sequencing and shotgun sequencing and so on, where people read strands of the genome and those little pieces have some deletions in them. So again, I'm not an expert on the practical connections, but somehow the interest in deletions seem to be increasing because of some biology application. And again, going back to these three challenges, first you want to understand what's the best redundancy, then you want to talk about algorithms. Turns out for a deletion model, even the first question, we have no idea. Okay, so let's go into that. So let's have the model where you have bits, and p fraction of the bits just get deleted. Don't think of p as like 1/10 or something. So basically you get only, you know, 1 minus pn of the symbols, and you need to figure out what the code word would be. So you can ask, what's the minimum redundancy as a function of p? If 1/10 of my symbols go missing, get deleted, what's the minimum redundancy I can operate with? Way too hard. Okay, this is hopeless, so currently it seems. A simpler question, which I like a lot, is the following. Let's ask one extreme. So instead of asking the trade-off between redundancy and p, let's ask, what is the largest p you can, how big can you make p? How noisy can your channel be, for which I can still do some meaningful coding? Which means my redundancy is bounded away from 1. So not all my symbols are redundant. Even this is not known. Okay, and again, let me give you a little more intuition about this. So the question is, I have a binary code, and I want it to be, you know, somewhat big. So I have size like this. But I want it to correct a p fraction of worst case deletions. How large can p be? So I've said this, certainly p less than half. Even see why. So if p is half, if my channel can delete half the bits, there's not much I can do against this channel. Okay, why? Well, the channel can just observe the code word. Either the zeros or ones occur at most half the time. So I can delete the less frequent of the two, so I'll only get two possibilities at the receiving end. So I can only send one bit across. Right? So if the channel can delete half the bits, basically, you know, you can go home. Right? There's nothing you can do against this channel. But it turns out, what we don't know is if we can actually achieve p close to 1/2. So I should have put that in the slide. So we do not know if this is the only limit. So is it possible that if p is 0.499, whether we can do coding with positive rate? We don't know. Till recently, the best known was some non-constructive thing which said that you can correct 17% of deletions. And in recent work, we improve this and say that we can correct a deletion fraction approaching, you know, 41.4%. And further, we actually give these codes explicitly and also construct them. So at least we say that if you want to correct deletions, I can handle up to these many deletions with a good code. Okay, and so I think in the interest of time, I'll probably not sketch what the construction looks like, but I just want to at least mention this result that we have new codes which can correct up to these many deletions. So I'll skip these things, which I sort of expected to skip anyway. But the open problem here is that we achieved 41%, but you can ask, is half really the actual limit, or is there some other non-trivial limit? So can you actually construct codes which can allow you to correct a deletion fraction approaching half? And you can state this, it's a very accessible question in the sense that you can state it in purely combinatorial terms. So what actually dictates deletion correction is actually the longest common subsequence between two code words. Because if two code words have a long common subsequence, you can delete all but the rest, and then you will get those two code words confused. So the problem really is that whether you can have, so here is a prove or disprove this thing. Suppose you have a code where for any pair of distinct code words, their longest common subsequence is, you know, at most 0.51 times n. Then must such a code necessarily be small, or can you find such a code with 2 to the omega n code words? So basically, what's the price you need to pay for avoiding long common subsequence? And somehow this is not very well understood. Okay, so that's a very basic question which we do not know. And so the last thing I'll talk about in the last, you know, few minutes is going back to something very simple. We started with the erasure thing, and we talked about more complicated models, deletions, and so on. But the remarkable thing with coding is that with the demands of new technology and new things, even very basic questions take new incarnations. And we realized that we didn't know even how to solve these optimally. And this is just one erasure. So what do I mean by this? So we went to this read solve. This is how I started the talk, where I said you can, given any k of these n symbols, you can figure out what the polynomial is. And this is actually very useful because you can use these things to store data across the cloud. So you can have k servers worth of non-redundant data, but you distribute it on n servers. And the point is, if any n minus k of the servers fail, catastrophically, you can still figure out all the data. And this is, for example, Facebook, for a good chunk of their data, uses this with k is 10 and n is 14. So even if 4 of their servers fail for data storing a particular person's records, they can still get it back, even in the worst case. But what is actually increasingly important in these distributed storage, cloud storage thing is that one server suddenly goes unavailable, or temporarily unavailable, or just fails. And this happens all the time. And they need to bring back this server. So they need to find a replacement server which has the contents of this server. Now the question is how, you know, and since they have to do this quite a lot, the question is how efficiently can you do this? So of course you can, you know, these codes have a lot of resilience. So you can go to k of these servers, download their data in entirety, and you can recover this particular node. But this seems a bit wasteful, because downloading k servers data is enough to reconstruct the entire thing. Whereas you're missing only one piece of information, can you recover that more efficiently? More, what does efficiently mean? I'll come to that in a second. Can we do better by leveraging the fact that you're only correcting one server failure? And since this happens a lot and this data are very big, it's very important to solve this efficiently. And a quick answer might be that it turns out for the kind of codes I showed you, if you only contact k minus one servers, and even if you had their data in entirety, you have no idea about the contents of the failed server. Because any k things determine the data, if you only look at k minus one, you have no clue about the data of any one server. So it seems like, you know, one cannot do better. But turns out you can do better by just changing what we mean by better. Right? So, and this is in a meaningful way. Right? So what we want to do here is that you have this failed situation again, but you allow the repair scheme, which repairs the node, to not download a server in entirety, but actually only download fragments from that server. Okay? So you download partial information from these servers, and then you combine them to figure out what the total, what this thing would be. And it turns out the motivation here is to reduce the network bandwidth. Instead of downloading k servers entirely, you maybe contact all the other servers, but you download only a small amount of information from each. And then the repair problem is exactly what are the trade-offs. So for this very simple problem of replacing one erasure, you have a new question here, because you have a new metric by which to measure your error correction. Okay? And there's a whole area now called regenerating codes which addresses this. It's a very rich field with hundreds of papers. So it's, again, so again, the one thing I want to mention is that, so if you go back to this Reed-Solomon example, suppose one value goes missing, you can certainly do traditional interpolation and use k evaluations to figure it out fully, but that requires about k log n bits downloaded, because you have k, you go to k nodes, and then for each one of them, sigma is at least size n, so you need to download these many things. Right? And because of this, somehow Reed-Solomon codes were quickly banished as not being suitable for this problem. On the other hand, Reed-Solomon codes are still heavily used in practice, so you would like to have better schemes for an existing code rather than have some newfangled code. So a question which we wondered is that do these old Reed-Solomon codes themselves have better repair schemes in this new thing? And I'll just tell you what the one example theorem is. So again, the naive scheme would be downloading about n log n bits. So in work with Mary Wouters this year, we showed that This is just a particular instantiation. So if you have a system where k is n over 2, so rate is 1/2, it turns out if one node goes missing, you can of course go to n over 2 nodes and download them fully. But what you can also do is go to all the other n minus 1 nodes and just download one bit from each one of them for a total of n minus 1 bits. And we also showed that's absolutely the best you can do, so you cannot do better. So for me, what was interesting was that in addition to, you know, addressing this question of storage thing, it's really basically just a fun theorem about polynomial interpolation, which is something which we have known for a long time. And now here we have some new theorem about polynomial interpolation, which addresses a different metric, which is how much data do you get from the other nodes. And you know, that's a new metric and it leads to new things. And then this turns out, follow-up work shows that Reed-Solomon codes can actually be quite good and competitive with other tailor-made proposals as well. Okay, so I think that's all I have. Sorry, I rushed a little bit the last part. So the summary is that coding theory has many classical problems and models, but despite its age and these problems being well studied, there are still many new challenges and it's still progressing quite nicely. In particular, for this talk, I focused only on problems motivated from a communication or a storage angle. But turns out there's a lot of work in coding which is also motivated by connections to cryptography and complexity. So there is a lot of work on locally correctable codes, non-malleable codes, which is a notion in cryptography, and private information retrieval and so on. I didn't even mention these things. So there's a lot of other codes that are more useful beyond the settings I mentioned. And what is also interesting is that, and partly I mentioned the last segment to illustrate this, is that new directions continue to emerge in reaction to, because these codes are actually used. So we had this new metric of how much data you need to download. And then we realized even for this, what we think of as a trivial problem of correcting one missing symbol, there are things which we didn't know about it, and we still, in some sense, there are still open questions even on that problem. So somehow there are some lots of new directions which continue to emerge. So this regenerating codes was one example, but there are a lot of other things. So flash memories are becoming increasingly prominent, so there are nice questions on coding there and so on. So it turns out, for all these reasons, both fundamental and technological, it seems like it's a good time to work in coding theory. So, thanks. So the scheme as shown here will work for any IID. I mean, with our theorems for general alphabets, will work for any IID source for any finite alphabet. So in that sense, text is completely fair game. But I doubt if just your compression is your metric, this will be the most competitive thing. Because there is this restriction of linearity here, which you may not care about for any, you know, compression scheme, right? So yeah, so and if it's not IID, definitely these things don't work. So. At least, I mean, the theorems don't hold. They might still, you can still try the codes, but there's no guarantees on how they'll do. So.
One other question is for this distributed to the from the very last part.
Yeah.
It's repairing one erasure. So I understand by, it's really nice that you can use Reed-Solomon code, but in terms of alphabet size or anything, do they perform any better than the other regenerating
that are in. So it really depends on the, yeah, so there is this one parameter called subpacketization in these regenerating codes. And for some of the regimes where they work, there is no other alternative. Reed-Solomons are the best. So if for very small subpacketization, they are very good. And in fact, this follow-up work I mentioned said that if you only care about this total bandwidth, where there is this thing called the cut-set bound, which is the best you can hope for, you can even construct some codes where you can get close to the cut set bound. But then the subpacketization, which is related to alphabet size, starts growing. So again, the full picture is not understood. But the pieces we know seems to suggest that they are pretty good. at both ends, like where you fix, you try to minimize the alphabet size and then you say what bandwidth you can get, they're doing pretty well. And you say, well, I really need to nail down the optimal bandwidth, and they're also, they're doing quite well.
Okay.